Hey everybody, Sourdough here. Today, before we start the show, I want to tell you about our upcoming conference, the Not Real Art Conference on March 16th here in LA. It's a one-day learning event for artists to come together and learn, share, network, and grow. We're going to talk about protecting your IP, licensing your IP, and pitching your IP to Hollywood. Tickets are right now at $100. We got some great speakers, experts, artists talking. We got Human, we got Logan Hicks, we got Jorge Gutierrez, and of course we got your boy Man One, and we've got experts from Hollywood and New York coming to talk about the law, talking about pitching to Netflix, all kinds of exciting stuff. So go to notrealart.com to get your tickets today. Thanks so much. Now let's start the show.
Hello, this is Siri and you're listening to my favorite podcast, Not Real Art. I live for this shit cause it's totally lit.
Welcome to Not Real Art, Siri's favorite creative culture podcast with the one and only Sourdough.
Yeah, woohoo!
Yeah.
Sourdough.
Sourdough, that's my pseudonym. I'll explain later
okay. If
you're interested. Today is a very special day because my general partner in crime, my usual partner in crime, Man One, who is my co-host most days, is not here. Today I am joined by two very special guests who are going to help me steer this ship today. We've got JonMarc.
Hello.
And we've got Ando Love.
Hey.
Guys, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Yes, thank you.
I'm looking forward to it.
Happy New Year.
What are you looking forward to?
Well, usually don't look forward to the new year because I'm still working on last year getting stuff done.
Yep.
So this year, I got all my work documented for my website coming up.
Big project.
Did all that stuff. You know, that's like inventory stuff and getting it all. So I'm done with that. So I'm looking forward to, I finished some series of work and I kind of cleaned my slate at the end of last year. And now I'm ready to go and get some new inspirations, if you will.
JonMarc, what was, looking back on 2018, what was your proudest moment?
My proudest moment? Well, let's see. Artistically, I would say doing the Flutter piece at Search and Rescue downtown.
I was there. It's amazing.
Yeah. And that was a big moment. And whenever I travel, I always have big moments, mm-hmm. whether it's swimming in a lake, you know, you can recall some of those times being out on the beach. I have some favorite moments like that.
Ando, what about you? What was 2018? What were some proud moments for you?
A lot of amazing moments. Getting into a new studio space and setting the intentions for creating new work. One major highlight was overseeing and being a part of the Tatsu restaurant install that happened in New York, which was pretty amazing because that was a year-long project in the making, and finally getting it to seeing it in place was pretty memorable. And really, you know, all throughout the year, I think there's highlights in the day.
But so for our listeners in New York, where's the restaurant? Where can they go to check it out?
So Tatsu Ramen is in East Village, mm-hmm. along the strip of many other ramens. But yeah. I have to say Tatsu is probably one of the most yummiest ramen, yeah. ramen that I've had. And so it's been a really fun project working on the restaurant and also developing other various products, mm-hmm. to celebrate the space and its overall vision.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, that was a really good, fun one. Of course, collaborating with this amazing artist, JonMarc, has been a great highlight to the addition.
He's trying.
It's funny how things happen, right? And people that we meet in this path of travel and sharing like interests in what we do collectively.
Well, how did you guys connect? Because, Ando, you and I go back and we met through Crew West Gallery.
Correct.
But JonMarc and I are just now really kind of getting to know each other, which is a beautiful thing. But how do you guys go back? How did you meet?
I was looking for the best laser cutter in LA, mm-hmm. and
you found him,
and I found him, yep. through different resources, and came knocking on your studio door one day. Do you recall?
I do.
And I brought all my samples, and I'm like, "Can you cut this for cheaper?"
Yeah,
and he goes, "Well, I don't know if I can do it cheaper, but I can do it better."
There you go.
That was good.
Well, yeah, that was a beautiful moment. And
when was that? How many years ago?
Well, 5 years ago. About 5 years ago, I think. Yeah.
2018.
Right. Well, good.
Good stuff.
Yeah. So we'll talk about Flutter, but what other projects besides or in addition to Flutter have you guys worked on together? Just as it's sort of like countless, I mean, is it hard to recall?
Well, Ando's done a lot of laser cutting for me. I use laser cutting to create stencils of usually letters of different sizes. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I use them in a lot of different ways, either 3D performance installation on paintings. I pretty much use language as a concrete tool or device to get my creativity in action.
I have to say, JonMarc, that I've reviewed your work. I've looked at your website and everything, and you have all this amazing, beautiful work. I love your work. And I mean this sincerely. It's very beautiful. However, I'm a little concerned you may not know how to spell.
It's been a problem sometimes.
Hey, so what happens with spelling, I'll tell you about this kind of, at least for myself, right? And the way in which letters become graphic. They're no longer words, but they're how we see them visually, right? And it's not by any means discrediting JonMarc here, but I find myself in this place of, the exploration of ideas where a type is being used. It no longer becomes words. It becomes shapes and forms and negative and positive spaces. And, you know, Illustrator doesn't have spell check, which does not work.
That's a good idea.
So there are these areas also as you get lost in words or letters that I find myself still doubting a lot of the times when I'm even staring at something that has been spelled correctly and still spell checking it and double checking. And it's a part of it, too. And
is there a specific piece? I mean, I might have to go back to, you know.
Yeah, I saw a typo in a few.
A typo.
Well, no, you know, and it's, look, I mean, I'm not going to sit here and blow sunshine. The reality is, JonMarc, when I went to Flutter, I didn't know what to expect, right? I mean, I had heard about it from Ando. And I love Ando, and Ando and I go way back. So I was like, okay, if he says it's dope, it's dope. I'm going to go check it out. So I didn't, but I didn't really know what to expect. He tried to explain it a little bit, but I'm not that bright. So, you know, I had to go like see it for myself. And boy, was I delighted. I mean, it's just the warm, fuzzy feeling I got. I mean that in all sincerity. Like, it was just a beautiful, really innocent, yet profound and kind of powerful experience to be sort of walking through meaning, if that even makes sense, you know, because the letters were falling down like snowflakes, obviously in completely random, kind of chaotic kind of way, like snowflakes do. And yet somehow there was great meaning in that. And then to watch people, myself included, start spelling words and things on the floor with the letters. And I don't know, it opened up my mind. I guess what I'm getting at is it opened up my mind to what Ando's saying about the abstract nature of letters. I mean, they're just random shapes, right?
Right.
Like, and then yet somehow they come together. But this has been a core focus of your work for decades, right? I mean, letters and meaning and words and...
Yes, language and letters and words being very elastic. Mm-hmm. I'll do one project, and by doing that project, it will take me on to a new project because of the elasticity. And so Flutter, what was great about that, it's for all ages, and you would find kids on the floor spelling words.
Yep.
And adults jumping in the air trying to grab letters and falling in people's hair. And it was, you know, it was just a great experience to see that happen.
I have to confess that the word I spelled was boobs.
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 Okay. Well, we know where your mind goes all the time.
So, yes. My wife always says, you know, I dumb things down. So, you know, here we go.
You know, there's the X-rated Flutter.
Yeah.
And you can get pretty wild. You can...
That's the next show.
Questions.
That's a version 2 coming up.
So in terms of Flutter specifically, though, how many weeks or months in development? I mean, what was your inspiration? I mean, what was the journey, right? Because, I mean, there was a lot of love put into that show, a lot of energy, a lot of money. You know, take us through kind of the journey.
Well, what happened is I had like 200 pounds of text that I wasn't doing anything with, and I dumped it on the floor and just scattered it.
Did you say 200 pounds of text?
Yeah, it's like barrels of it. wheelbarrows and you just walked around and kicked it. And I noticed from some shows, people, like kids mostly, would slide through it, you know, and throw it. And it was just very active and people weren't spelling words or trying to read it. And it was just really fun to be active with letters, because you would stop, pause, make a word perhaps, or say, look at this. It happened to see the word supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. That's so weird. And the kids would just slide right through it then. You
right,
know,
right.
There
right.
goes the moment.
Yeah.
And finally, I'm like, I wonder if I could take, you know, and from the throwing, it would go through the air and you're watching it kind of fly through the air with the greatest of ease. And then I'm like, hey, what if I made this, you know, cut this material lighter and it could just kind of float? How am I going to create a device that's going to launch this thing?
Right.
And so after doing some experimentation, Ando came over and then we sat down and really started thinking about this seriously, how to create a vehicle for the text to flutter and snow.
Right.
In a large area. I mean, the idea is for it to be, I want to rent out these large Kmarts that are going belly up or Sears or whatever and start using that kind of scale to have people walk through.
There's a lot of vacant mall space out there.
Yeah. I like vacant.
Right. Big spaces.
Yeah. I think that's a new artistic place to go do your stuff.
But the challenge, because one of the things that I appreciated when I walked through the space that day was that it really felt like you were getting great coverage. Like the letters were, it wasn't like there was just one spot of the letters kind of falling down. It really had a nice, the only word I keep coming to is coverage. Like it really kind of filled the room as it was kind of floating and raining down. How challenging was that? And how did you guys, what were the mechanisms and how did you figure that out? Because that must have taken some time.
Yeah, well, you know, these were all just kind of somewhat ideas based on the early studies or thinking about how we can create a space that would allow the letters to not rain down, but kind of fill the space as you're walking in and exploring or experiencing it on that level. So the first time when I got kind of the experience when JonMarc called me over to his studio and with very little idea of what I was in for, he asked me to stand in a specific location in his space. And he said, stand right here, don't move, and walked around. And for a minute, I was not sure what was going to happen. And all of a sudden, these letters started to kind of drizzle from above, and I realized that he created a mock-up of this idea of letters kind of raining, fluttering.
I guess for our listeners' benefit, I think maybe a word that we haven't used, and JonMarc, forgive me if you don't like this word, but like for people to visualize what we're talking about, it's like confetti, right?
Correct.
It was like a ticker tape kind of parade,
right?
Things are raining down from the sky.
Correct.
Like that's what we're talking about.
Yeah, true. And Flutter was an alliteration of Twitter in that there's all this like extra wordage and transparency of ideas and meaningless exclamations going on in the world. And where does this all go?
Right.
And Flutter kind of exemplifies what's actually going on.
Yeah.
You know, so that's a good way to think about it, is all this useless information doesn't just dissipate, it actually lands somewhere and someone regurgitates it or whatever. And so Flutter has a lot of metaphorical ways to look at it.
Absolutely.
Or I mean, experience it.
Right. You know, it's interesting to me because one of my pet peeves about the art world is the preciousness that we can have about our work and the pretension.
Don't touch.
And then,
don't
right,
get
you know,
too close.
And this was totally immersive. Right. It was totally, it was all about interplay and interactivity and getting in there and touching it and messing it around. Yet at the same time, to your point about the layers and levels of meaning here, you know, it was a reminder of just how precious our words and letters are, and yet we waste them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I don't know. I mean, it was one of my takeaways, because I know one of the things that I'm guilty of is talking too much and maybe not saying much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're talking, but I hear you talking, but you're not saying anything. You know, I guess economy of words, economy, you know, like making measured, intentional, making sure we're using our words, you know, with intention and with purpose and not wasting what is so valuable.
Yeah. I mean, in the show, we had shelves and pedestals, and the text would fall on it, and suddenly it becomes an object.
Right.
And you could either deal with it as an object, or you could literally blow it away, mm-hmm, off the shelf, or, mm-hmm, you know, take it off the pedestal, and you're interacting with it as well. And no one's going to come up to you and say, don't do that or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And it just, as the flutter just keeps raining down or coming down, it just keeps piling up, you know. I don't know if you know the book, Dr. Seuss, Ublick.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So it was, that was kind of in the back of my mind where,
right,
no matter what you do with this stuff, it just keeps coming and,
yeah,
coming.
Yeah.
And there's, you can't get rid of it. And that's language for me and text and...
Well, and it's
social media.
Right, right. Yeah, we're just drowning in fucking, yeah. You know, we call it content, right? It's like we're drowning in content. And the irony, right, is that now more than ever, we need to figure out how to communicate and build empathy through communication. And yet at the same time, we are overwhelmed in such a way that it almost makes it impossible to get to know each other in a real way.
Well, another aspect too is that we use recyclable and biodegradable materials, so you can do this, the piece can go outside and, you know, right, I've taken bags of this and thrown it in corners of, you know, dilapidated motels downtown LA, yeah, and, you know, 2 weeks later it's gone or it's mush and, you know, it's clogging up the sewer system.
Well, I have to tell you, and it's been... what, 6 months or so,
okay,
since we took the show down, which was...
I know where this is going.
There are things that are still coming up in the studio of letters. Out of nowhere, there'll be a sprinkle of something that falls off a shelving or an area that I haven't yet opened. And, you know, here it is, some letters. And
finding an LMNOP in your couch?
Yeah. And it's one of these things that, you know, David, my studio mate, you know, we kind of jokingly were saying this while the install was happening. I was saying like, man, we're going to have fucking letters for I don't know how long.
They're like neutrinos.
So
they just permeate
pockets.
Every part of your existence.
And just the other day, as I was looking for some material, pulled out a long strip of a paper bag that I had. As I opened it, I realized there was all these letters that were tucked in there. And David was, you know, in the mezzanine space, and I was downstairs, and I was like, fucking JonMarc, man. He's everywhere. We can't get away, you know. And we just busted laughing because
you can't use those letters to spell fungus.
There we go.
So jokingly, I was saying that what we should do is just gather all the letters that we're still finding, and mail it to JonMarc with an invoice.
Oh my God, how funny is that? Right. You should just, yeah.
We're still
like the
cleaning
crew giving me.
So, I mean, this was,
but it's great.
You know, it was a remarkable experience, at least for me, obviously for you guys, the creators, the producers. You know, we don't want to hide our light under a bushel. I know the show is over, but, you know, 2019 is a new year. Where does Flutter go from here? What's next?
We're looking at new spaces to, you know, you want to do something new. I want to take it outside of a gallery context.
Right.
A lot of people, like Ando is alluding to, there's a cleanup element to it that maybe some galleries, although I've shown it in different galleries, you know, and outside of...
Definitely makes taking it to Burning Man challenging, I'll tell you that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, well, you can burn it when
well,
you're
you
done
go.
With it.
There you go. Yeah.
But I just like challenging environments, so we're going to see. I'm working on different things.
Mm-hmm.
There's really nothing to present right now.
Right, right.
But I'll come back when I have my...
Please do. Please come back and tell us about it.
Yeah. So it's R&D right now.
Yeah.
Because I've done it 3 or 4 times now. And so we want to take it to different corners of the world.
Sure. Absolutely. Well, you know, getting back to that whole topic about, you know, letters as abstract forms, right? This is exactly why one of the reasons why I love traveling in Asia, right? Because the letter forms mean nothing to me. Like there's like, it's not, you know, like, right. So they just become these beautiful, you know, shapes and beautiful forms. And there's, you know, I don't have a snowball's chance in hell of like trying to decipher what that says. I just know it looks really fucking cool. And I wish I could read it. JonMarc, I know you lived in Asia at one point in your life, Japan, I think.
Yes. Kyoto.
So talk about that. I mean, that must have been hugely formative for you.
Definitely. Well, the same experience. I went there for school and ended up wanting to learn more about Japanese, the language, the characters, and found myself, why isn't English more interesting to look at? Sometimes old English, you know, the cursive writing,
calligraphy,
can look really cool. But so I came back and I started compressing text into characters so they were legible, but at the same time you had to decipher it. Mm. And I did a lot of work with that. There were basically 5 principles to deconstruct it. And so what happened is some of my paintings would have anywhere from 50 to 90 characters. So you really were in a situation where you weren't reading them as much as looking at it again, like a mosaic. Mm-hmm. And to read it would take you too long and make you very pissed off, you know, to be spending so much time asking very basic questions about humanity. But no, I mean, that's what I spent my 90s the 90s doing, was that type of work.
What are the five merge? Yeah, please.
Yeah.
It's called what?
Merge? It's called merge. Yeah. And it's compressing text into a single character. It's monosyllabic.
Okay.
So each character is a syllable. So if you're doing multi, then each character, it would be, let's see, the biggest letter is the first letter you'd read.
Mm-hmm.
And then it would go towards the middle. And so if you had like a word thought, which has 7 letters. I'm a bad speller, remember?
Give or take. 7,
you
give or take.
Start with the biggest letter and then go from top to bottom, left to right, concentrically. So like the last T in thought would probably be somewhere in the middle of that character. Tiny, you know. But it was consistent. So as you got a hand for deciphering the words, started slowly just, there's...
Right, you became proficient.
Yeah, you would become, and it was a great way for me to be philosophical or, you know, angry and say things that if you just wrote them freehand might not come off the same way.
Right,
so...
Well, you mentioned 5 principles. What are those 5 principles?
The biggest letter read first, then top to bottom, left to right. And if there's a line that bisected the character, that meant there were 2 syllables in one character. Because a lot of times, like words like of or you know, you didn't want to give over to a whole character of an A.
Right.
So you would make it interesting by having it share a space, things like that.
Ando, we've got to up our game, my man.
Yeah, let's.
Look at JonMarc over here is fucking killing it.
Yeah. Well, the conceptualizing of ideas is always great. It's interesting because a lot of this that I'm hearing also kind of speaks about graffiti, right?
In some ways. Exactly. I was thinking that myself. Yep.
In the ways that we communicate this area of expression and creativity. I myself am a product of that culture when it was still so young and beautiful in the way that hip hop was, you know, was accessible.
Right.
And, you know, I come from that background and somehow you never really get out of that mind state. You're constantly in this place of formulating these conceptualizing of letters and graphic expressions. And, you know, when I was in junior high school, you know, I was a graffiti writer, a tagger, but I was also a breakdancer and doing popping and everything that was, you know, finding creativity and expression.
Right. I really wanted to use that breakdance that Smash recorded of you.
Oh, yeah.
And he didn't want to include it.
That was so fun.
In the longer version of the video, yeah, we'll include that. Yeah.
So I found myself in this place of, you know, finding identity, right, as a young artist, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And none of my parents come from that background of artistry. So, you know, finding it in such a natural way and having such a rainbow of friends and culture in my neighborhood growing up. Graffiti was hip hop was the unifying factor of it all.
Right.
Everyone came in and brought something super fresh to it.
Yeah.
And that expression form, you know, from, let's say, doing airbrushing on t-shirts and things like this that I was doing in high school and finding my place to take letters and words in similar ways of, you know, bringing them together or writing in such a way that your mind has to study it and to making up what you're reading. It's kind of this area of graffiti that happened. And I still do that, you know, not graffiti, so to speak, on walls, but I still practice it in the way in which I think about things. You know, the visual process of finding this expression took me in so many different expressions and forms of not just color, but shapes and volume. And graffiti, hip hop took me into studying architecture and practicing architecture and finding other means to find expression outside of architecture that wasn't just buildings, as I have done and practiced and still am involved on various levels of the design and practice in which we explore volume is the same way we still do that in type, right? These negative shapes or sizes and how they're interlocked and what words mean in relation to a plan of a house, so to speak. And there's, you know, all these kind of interesting connections between how our mind develops and this playfulness of what we're doing and finding ways to communicate, you know, whether it's a flat dimension on a canvas or a sculptural exploration of ideas or this amazing experience of walking in a space that is just fluttered with letters and immersing yourself in this experience is something that has always been a passion of mine. And I'm a...
Yeah, well, I'm just curious, yeah. Ando, are you bilingual?
I am.
Yeah, how many languages do you speak?
My own.
Yeah. So bilingual, so you speak two languages.
So
yeah.
My native tongue is Armenian.
Yes.
So I'm an ESL, English as a second language student, so to speak. And and then English. But growing up in LA, you know, in Hollywood and having so many amazing friends to experience culture and language and communication, you know, Spanish I've picked up, you know, I'm not a very good speaker, but I understand more than I can speak Spanish. But, you know, that's another beautiful way of learning too, is simulating how do you communicate in Armenian is different than in English, right? So it's funny, but, you know, there are certain things that I say to people, I think Armenian, but speak English.
Yeah.
That doesn't really, you know, it's kind of how our minds work. And English sometimes is a reverse, right? And the way that we articulate and communicate our thoughts and ideas.
Now, is there Armenglish? Is that when you speak like part Armenian, part English, Armenglish?
Yeah, that happens. Okay. Interestingly enough, that happens with my sister and, you know, in conversation. But when growing up, you know, my parents would always say for us to speak Armenian at home.
Right.
So we'd still do it. And you know, through the years and having been raised in LA, I still find my place in neighborhoods and communities that I go into that are Armenian speaking, and I could speak to them and they're blown away as to how well I've been able to hold kind of the pure expression of words and things like this. Mm-hmm. And so.
Well, JonMarc, when you lived in Japan, were you speaking Japanese?
No.
Are you bilingual?
No, I was just, I speak English and hillbilly. That's about it. all I can.
I'm laughing because I also speak hillbilly.
Oh, you do? Where are you from?
Well, my dad's side of the family's from the South. And, you know, I think we're one paycheck away from, you know, being redneck, hillbilly, you know, white trash.
I'm from the Ozarks. So
okay. Okay.
That's well, a Bible Belt.
So, so I was born in Gary, Indiana.
Okay.
Okay. I grew up in the Rust Belt, the armpit of the nation, on the coast of Lake Michigan. So most of us, at least my friends and I, we aspired to get to Chicago. Chicago was the exotic promised land. Had I been born and raised 10 minutes south, I'd have been a farm boy. For sure. But my mom's side of the family was the city folk. They're from Indianapolis.
Ooh.
And my dad's side of the family is from the South, Louisiana, Texas, what have you. So, but the point I'm getting at, because I am not bilingual. I speak one language, but not that well, English.
You're right.
The language of love.
But the point is that I think about how, because I have many friends that speak multiple languages. I have one friend that speaks five languages. And the point is that I think about that within the context of how you view the world, how they view the world, how that helps to build empathy or maybe not. I don't know. But, you know, these are tools in our toolbox, right? And the more tools you have, the more functional and more valuable you can be in the world. And, you know, I should take more action to learn another language because I regret not having multiple languages. I often talk about, you know, we talk about the singularity. We talk about the technological infusion into our bodies. The only technology I might allow embedded into my head here would be something that would allow me to speak and understand all languages instantaneously. Right. That to me, if we could do that, that would solve a lot of problems because it would hopefully do the one thing that we need more than anything, which is create empathy. But I just think about that in terms of your work, in terms of your passion, in terms of your graffiti. You grew up in a multilingual community, a very diverse city of Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up in white America. Right.
Uh-huh.
And we barely spoke English well. You know.
So when I did a show in Amsterdam, I use text a lot. Mm-hmm. So not knowing Dutch, I worked with a Dutch translator. So that became a relationship in that talking about nuancing words. And so it was a relationship that was very interesting to talk to them about how they looked at language and English. And mm-hmm. so I found that when you're dealing with Spanish or German or some of these Indo-European languages, there's a connection there that although you're not speaking the same, you can kind of get the gist of things using your hands a lot. And at times I noticed drawing my, my actions or what I'm trying to get at. Mm-hmm. And I guess, the point is when you can't speak the same language, then you resort to different creative means to communicate.
Absolutely. And the one thing that has worked for me every fucking time, and I've been fortunate enough to travel to 39 countries and four continents, is my smile. Like, if a fucking smile, a smile will work so hard for you.
Okay.
I found it works for me. If I don't know that language, but if I enter the room with a smile and I look that person dead in the eye, and I show some humility and I'm smiling, like, that just opens doors and is a great a lubricant when you don't know the language.
So this is how you got your iPhone fixed.
Exactly.
Or when you have to use the restroom and Vietnam. Right. And,
or when I need to score drugs.
It's like big smile.
Right. Which reminds me of that. I happen to catch part of the movie Love Actually over the holiday season.
Of course.
And there's that whole storyline of the guy and the writer, and he's got the maid and they don't speak the same language, but they fall in love. Anyway, whatever.
Love that stuff.
Yeah, language is a powerful thing. I'm jealous. I have to confess, Ando, I'm a little jealous, you know.
It's never too late to learn, It's continued education. I think we're all still in this way of learning things.
I need to learn sign language because I'm deaf in my left
Amazing.
Ear. So
it's like taking gang sign to the next level.
Yeah. Well, I'm deaf in my left ear, so I figure, you know, with age, my right ear will go. So eventually I'll be totally deaf, and I'm going to need sign language.
Huh. Yeah, my son takes sign language in college. So
no kidding. Wait, what's his major?
It's archaeology of social media.
archaeology.
What a blender that is.
Wow, that is a sign of the times.
Yeah, it's a sign of the times. It's, you know, where did the internet come from, the origins, and then how different cultures use the internet mm-hmm. or social media to express themselves or gather information, as we know. And it's a very, yeah, I mean, who knows where he'll end up, but that NYU has such a department.
Ooh, smarty pants, NYU.
Oh,
he must take after his mother.
right. I said no art school for you, Buster.
So you've got one son in college. How many kids? You said you had two kids?
No, my daughter goes to college too.
Okay, so you've got two kids, both in college.
Yes, I'm an empty nester now.
Empty nester. So talk about your kids for 5 seconds. Like, are they artists? Or you said your son is not an artist.
Well, he is he has artistic inclinations. Sure. He likes filmmaking and he likes editing and photography.
Okay.
You know, he's more practical than I mm-hmm. am. Mm-hmm. He wants to get a job when he gets out of college. I would have chosen
JonMarc, you need to get a real job, man.
Yeah. Well, that's the artist dilemma. Get a real job. And my daughter's a writer and she writes great short stories and writes for the Blue and White at Columbia. So she's
couple of smarty pants.
Yeah, they're smart. And so I feel my work is done now.
Congratulations, brother. So, congratulations.
I can move on.
I'm a dad too, but my kids are on the other end of the spectrum at 6 and going on 2.
Right.
And so, you know, I got a journey. So I'll be calling you for tips.
Definitely. I'm here for you.
How often do you see them being in New York City and you being here in LA?
Probably every 3 or 4 months, maybe 5 months. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But they live close, you said, right?
They live close to each other. Well, that's great. You know, in terms of New York City. So.
Right.
They see each other every weekend, you know, so they're together on Sundays for home cooking.
What do they think about their artist dad?
They love my work. They, you know, they're very supportive and they come to all my shows and when they can. And they know my work really well. So it's always, I can bring a painting to them or they come to my studio and I can get their feedback pretty and know that it's coming from a place that I trust or, you know, they're like, that piece you did 4 years ago that's, you know, blue and in the storage, can you bring that out or, you know, like that or something like that. So, yeah. But I hopefully steered them away from the art as a first career, you know, and the struggles and tribulations that artists have. So I think they took my advice in that way.
What were some of the biggest, as an artist, both you guys, you know, we've been talking about earlier in the show as well, we talked about some of the highlights of 2018 and stuff. But I mean, the reality is that as artists, we struggle. There are dark times. Many of our colleagues, you know, even battle depression, things like this. Talk about some of the darker times you guys have been through and what got you through it.
Dark times. I've definitely had dark times, but I always felt that was a great time to be creative. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So in those dark times, I recall just moving to LA in 1990.
From where?
From Minneapolis.
Okay, because you moved all over. You've kind of lived all over the place.
Yeah. I mean, and so I went to school in Minneapolis, and then I went to New York, and then I came here. And not knowing a lot of people, and I had rented a great studio on Pico and Arlington area. Mm-hmm. And it was a great studio. You know that area?
Yeah.
And I didn't have a lot of friends, like I said, and just trying to get things together. And I kind of lived in the studio without turning the lights on for a week, you know, and just thought about what I was going to do.
How young were you? How young were you?
How young was I? In my 20s.
In your 20s.
And
this wasn't like recently where I was going
to
be.
By the way, this is literally a dark time because he did not turn the lights on.
I was taking your question literally. So thank you for catching that.
Yes.
But those are, you know, those transitions from moving and getting yourself situated can be kind of.
Yeah. Transitional times are challenging, but financially as well. I mean, let's talk nuts and bolts, bottom line stuff. I mean, you know, financially, those of us that work in the creative arts, I mean, it's sometimes feast or famine. I mean, how the hell do we manage, you know, you've got kids, you've got college bills, you know, Ando, you know, God knows how many kids Ando has, you know, this guy,
right.
You know,
Zello,
that you know about.
I love kids,
you know, but it's, yeah. I mean, but it's an interesting time to be an artist, right? It feels like, because on some level, artists have more opportunities now, maybe more than ever, at least in terms of going, be able to go direct to consumer via websites or e-commerce or what have you. That being said, there's more competition than ever now and more people, quote unquote, calling themselves artists and putting stuff out there, you know. Right. But let's not fool ourselves. I mean, I don't care what industry you're in. You know, business is hard. You know, making ends meet is hard. I was talking to a friend of mine. I used to work. I got my start as a graphic designer in Chicago, right? So I really came up through the commercial art side, mm-hmm. primarily in consumer products, brand marketing, right? So I did a lot of branding work, packaging design, product innovation, that kind of stuff. And worked for a bunch of the big agencies. And one of my friends who's still with an agency that I was at, agency's called Anthem Worldwide. They have offices all over the world, 30-some offices, publicly traded company. I was talking to them the other day. They work with the biggest companies in the world, Coca-Cola, Pepsi, so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. And he was telling me that it is taking them up to 1 year to have their invoices paid.
Whoa.
Wow.
Right. Now, that's a publicly traded company working with the biggest companies in the world.
Yeah.
Which, you know, like, good luck, right?
You have to get a bank loan to secure.
Flow. And, you know, and yet here we are, right? Cottage industry, artists, designers, architects, what have you. It's, you know, business is a struggle. It's a struggle out there.
Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, I can't really say I've had any off lights, dark moments in this kind of place of entering, knowing that it feels good. Mm-hmm. I think these are the areas of, I didn't go to art school. I studied architecture.
Right. Where'd you go?
Cal Poly Pomona. I got out and got a job working at a small boutique that was doing sustainable architecture and things that were of my interest of coming out of architecture and wanting to be a conscious thinker behind what I was doing and the impact in which architects are having on the planet. So interest in solar panels, drought tolerant landscaping, you know, green architecture, which this was back in 2000, was kind of a foreign concept to a lot of people because they were like, well, why do we need that? And you know, those were the places where I felt most interested in practicing this way of thinking. And so finding this kind of process in which I found myself wanting to explore other fundamentals of design, not just architecture, was the area of leaping, you know, taking a leap of faith into something that I knew it wasn't sitting behind the desk and working for someone. As much as I enjoyed it, there were these moments of love-hate relationships. It's a rewarding career to exercise this creativity in building and seeing the process in architecture is pretty amazing, but it's such a long process. You know, it's an old man's profession, as they say, that by the time you get to really practice your sense of creativity, you know, you're done. So there was this area of wanting to still find this fruitfulness of being expressive and communicating and doing other things outside of architecture, which is where I found myself being more interested in graphic design and motion graphics. And somehow that allowed me to look into ways to communicate through things that I was documenting in my surroundings and having kind of a story to tell. So Search and ResQ, my company, who does all things creative, as I like to say, because there isn't one thing that I can't do and not capable of, and finding the resources based on my experience and education and surrounded by so many amazing makers and shakers in LA that get it done. I can rely on this source of quality control. So Search and Rescue was this area of practice, which at the time I was calling social studies, because I was interested in looking at conditions that were happening in the fabric of our city. The homeless condition in downtown LA being one of them was an area that I found interest in, especially coming out of architecture school and then realizing that what is going on in our backyards here. And, you know, went through this kind of way in which having a point and shoot camera, documenting it, and just for self-knowledge and being more aware of these conditions in our neighborhoods, I started reading more and understanding the demographics of what is Skid Row and how did it come about and what is, who are all these people, you know, and the questioning of self, of what's the difference between us, you know, and a lot of Vietnam veterans, single mothers, families, and all these people that, you know, were in this hard place in life. And that to me was of interest to somehow give the voice to the unheard, of finding a way to photograph them, document them, and then taking these images, translating them into graphics that were bringing awareness into social issues, hence the social studies and homeless being one. But under this umbrella of like search and rescue, it could also be in areas of any interest. Currently, what I'm doing is collaborating with like-minded people that share the sense of bringing into the betterment of what we are doing as artists and as thinkers, and how can we actively work towards a campaign of whatever level of interest that we have, that we could bridge all of these great minds and to bring attention to something that we feel is on a humanitarian level of addressing. So I know this is on a tangent. However, at that time in this pursuit of it, I realized that I was starting something that was making me feel good. I was more excited about getting out of my position in architecture and going home and pursuing this area of interest that I had that somehow started to take form. So it was a place where I realized that I was most happy. And so I became, or was in this process of becoming, an entrepreneurial thinking of like, well, if I leave my job, I only have maybe 3 months that I could hold my rent money. But what I'm doing here creatively and envisioning what I want to do felt so good that the decision making of that leap of faith of getting out of a full-time job in a well-paid job at the time, and then coming and slowly chiseling off all the fat that didn't really needed to be in my way of experiencing life with my family and friends and my relationships and things like this, was of more of interest of how I spend my time.
Sure.
Not like working for someone and going in on the weekends of, oh man, fuck, I got this birthday party, but I can't go to because I got a deadline Monday. I have to go to the city or some bureaucratic bullshit behind architecture, which, you know, my gut feeling was unhealthy.
Right.
So it was these places of like really listening to the voices in your head. Like, you know, it's the 4 out of 5 voices in your head tell you to do it. It's that one that's like,
you only have 4 or 5 voices in your head. Well, I feel like I've got
it's
way
that
more.
Moment where you're like, I feel so good. Can I do this? And it's like, yes. You know, the only difference between this practice of like anyone else is the way we think about it and the action we put towards attaining anything we want in our life. So, you know, when I started to develop Search and Rescue as a brand and as a kind of a multidisciplinary studio, taking on many projects, not just architecture, but product design and customization, and, you know, meeting amazing artists like JonMarc and various other friends that I've made along the way, I invested in a laser cutter. And this was 10 years ago.
Right.
So
Nobody had laser. You were one of the first dudes in LA with a laser cutter.
Yeah,
right?
It was, you know, we were like maybe 2-3 other guys, myself and my studio mate, Mike Russick.
Shout out, Mike.
Yeah, totally. We're the only kids in LA playing with lasers. And, you know, when I got this machine, shit, I didn't know what to do.
By the way, for our listeners, yeah. JonMarc is holding up his hands and he's like clearly cut off a couple fingers with lasers. Sorry, Ando, didn't mean to interrupt. Yeah. That was funny.
So those were the things that, you know, as I was developing the brand and kind of the vision of Search and Rescue, it was a way for me to not only tap into little things, but exploring all these other things that I knew I had understanding in. Studying architecture is the same way in which graphic designers do a layout. You know, we do it in a floor plan, they do it in a different way through text or color or visuals, right? So we're still communicating things. And as I like to say in conversation with people is that I'm a visual communicator of ideas of whatever it is, but I just use whatever medium that we want to explore. You want to do furniture? Dig it. I got it. You want to do an installation? I understand the concept. I'm very process driven. And I think that's where I ended up finding myself falling in love with being an artist, so to speak, even though artist is such a loose term because we do so much more than just paint pretty pictures, you know? So, but in this way of finding this feel-good vibration made me understand that there's more to life than architecture. So it was this place where I was like, okay, cool. I got a good knowledge base to understand how this thing works. I appreciate it. I could still go back to it and still and practice on some level. But and then there were areas where I felt I still wanted to play. I still wanted to be creative and do this. So I've always been in this place of like change and wanting of understanding like what's next, right? I've always been curious of like,
you're a seeker.
A dream seeker, yeah, right? And that's kind of one of the main characters in Search and Rescue's first thing is like, I'm a dream seeker. I like to like do things I have yet to do and explore and figure it out. And then I think that's what, you know, really at the end of the day makes me happy.
Right.
You know, is working and having clients or projects or sharing my time with people that appreciate that I could bring value to whatever it is that we're creating together. And I'm just a conduit to an idea that they have.
Sure.
But it's taught me a lot. You know, it sounds, you know, because I didn't go to business school either. So there, I was in this position of understanding like, okay, now that I'm in this a free thinker, so to speak, and running and doing my own thing, I had to understand how to run and kind of operate on a business level of clients and all of these other things that I had some sort of a foundation understanding doing billing and architecture, but there was this whole other level of responsibility and discipline.
Sure.
That you now have to be, you know, a starter. You're not going in there and someone's telling you to do it. You know, you have to do it.
Yep.
And Rainmaker. That's the attitude that you have to have in this place of being fresh,
right?
You know, and that's always the thing is you have to always sharpen your tools. And that's the one most valuable thing that I will never, ever regret is doing Search and Rescue has taught me so much about what I'm capable of.
Sure.
And it's still, I'm still learning and wanting to know what's next, you know, because I like to, you know, I do things, but there's a certain level of like, I've done that before. What's next? You know?
Right.
But it keeps it, you know, keeps you sharp, you know?
100%. And I think that's one of those things. It's like, you never, you know, if you stop learning,
you can't,
you're dead.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just, you know, the reality.
And anyone and everyone can do this, you know, it's a comfort level. And I think we've come to understand, maybe I could say this for JonMarc as well, is that you're constantly reinventing your ideas of thinking.
Right.
In ways of finding that sense of love and passion for being an artist.
Right.
And then also realizing you have to pay taxes on this other level of, you know, like, oh, fuck, you know, shit, I'm having all this fun.
Right.
But and then there's all these other things you have to learn about and be an adult. And I refuse, you know.
Adulting.
Adulting. Adultism.
Yeah, man. I mean, I was talking to a friend of mine the other day. He's, you know, 20 years my junior or something. And but, you know, I kind of knew him growing up. And for whatever reason, he asked my opinion about things and, you know, whatever. And he was all excited because he was going to go to graduate school. He was going to get his MBA.
What is he going in for?
Well, he's a master of business administration, but you know, I don't know what if he's focusing on finance or what, but he was going to business school, graduate business school. And he was so proud, and I was, you know, proud of him, but you know, he's like, "Oh, what do you think?" I said, "Well, I don't think you really want to know what I think, you know." And he goes, "No, no, no."
How much time do you have?
I go, "Because the ship has sailed, you know what I mean? Like you're in, like you're going." He's like, "Well, aren't?" And I'm like, "Well, if you had called me a year ago, I would have told you the last thing the world needs right now is another MBA.
Okay.
You know, yeah. like the problems facing,
well, here's JonMarc sending his kids to college.
Mankind, the existential problems facing mankind, mm-hmm. require the kind of fresh, novel, revolutionary creativity that artists and designers are adept at providing and giving. Let's be frank, a lot of these problems we're dealing with were created by MBAs in the first fucking place. Hmm. We need to balance the equation a little bit here and bring in more artists, more designers to because yes, business, you need business. You need to know how to run a business. You need to know how to manage a business. Absolutely. But like with anything, an obsession with the bottom line only drives dysfunction. You need to strike that balance. And capital can't fucking think itself out of a goddamn bag. I mean, if there were no artists in the world, talk about architecture. Think about, you know, capital needed artists to build Times Square, right? If there were not artists, no architects, there would be no Times Square. You'd have all that money and nothing to do with it, all that energy and nothing to do with it. So it's just, you know, it's, I can understand. I get angry too sometimes, you know, this, you know, the golden rule, you know, the person with the gold makes the rules. I mean, you know, at the end of the day, there's a symbiotic relationship that capital has with creativity.
Wait, did you just say the golden rule, the person with the gold makes the rules?
Yeah.
Wait. Is that how the golden rule happened?
Well, that seems to be the cynical definition.
Yeah. Sorry for the interruption.
Those of us who've been around the block more than once might be aware of how the world
tends to do unto others as they would do unto you.
Right.
That's the real, I mean, that's the one we grew up with.
Right.
You know,
anyway. What about Bitcoin rule?
The Bitcoin. Yeah, well, I was a billionaire and now I'm broke. I don't know. Blockchain's going to solve everything.
Bank on it.
You know, look, I want to be respectful of our time. Sure. You guys have been so generous and I feel like we could do this for hours more.
Yeah.
But you're right, man. I mean, you know, the level of perfect, because really what you're getting at, Ando, just to put a bow on this, right, is that, you know, we can indulge our passions and our calling to be creative and artists. And it is, we can wallow in that. Because that's our safe spot. That is our joy. That is our comfort zone.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But if you're serious about being a professional,
mm-hmm.
you know, embracing some, going out of our comfort zone and embracing and learning some of these important disciplines and rigors to be accountable and successful, sustainable mm-hmm. in your business. Yeah, you're going to have to fucking learn some accounting. You're going to have to learn some basic finance, you know.
Yeah. And you have to be more than anything, you're a self-starter. You
100%.
Know? So
100%.
And you never stop learning and you're always in this place of engaging on levels of things you hadn't really thought of.
Yep. So what's next for you, Ando? What's going on? Where can people find you, by the way?
What's next? Well, I'm usually tucked away at the brewery on Main Street, and there's so many breweries these days, but the one that we kind of know of in some way. I have my studio space there. I practice, you know, various things. Still figuring it out, man. You know, I come to realize that, you know, resolutions and things like this that people set, I don't really follow that jive. You know, I really appreciate days in my life as it unfolds and being grateful for what comes my way and knowing that I'm at the right place at the right time all the time. And
that's a beautiful sentiment, actually.
And it appears.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's like being present, right? In which we've kind of had these conversations in so many ways of these places of being, of just allowing yourself to be that, you know? So the focus is just to really be focused.
Yeah. Right.
You know?
And that's harder than ever these days with all the distractions.
It is. But, you know, life is as hard and is as easy as you want to make it. You know, if you allow yourself to get into all of this craziness, you know, of politicking, everything is just going to be crazy. But you have to allow yourself to have bite sizes, enough for you to understand or to chew on and realize, like, there's certain things I just spit out. Like, I don't really have any interest for. And I allow myself to at least practice this way of giving myself the separation, the outside world versus my inside world of what I want to create, how I want to see the world, you know? And so if I get bombarded with just nonsense of media, there's a level of volume I have to tone down
right.
and turn up my volume, because right. that's going to make me a better human being and a better human doing on what I want to create in my life. And surround myself with people of that nature, of that frequency of sharing this sense of moment in time, because that's all that's left, you know? Because we could sit and talk about he said, she said, but at the end of the day, let's talk about what we want to build together, you know? I want to build your bridge. I want to, you know, find a way to connect with other amazing artists. And that's what's beautiful for me in life, yep. you know? This fucking planet's going to keep spinning, you know?
Nature wins in the end.
Yeah, yeah.
Not necessarily human nature, though.
That's right.
The laws of nature is the practice in which...
But getting back to highlights of 2018, the Dems taking back Congress was a big highlight. And a shout out to the 25th and Katie Hill in Santa Clarita. I did some work up there. Nice. And especially a lot more people than me obviously helped. And it was a great feeling to see all that happen in January.
Yeah, for sure. For sure.
And hopefully get a little more balance. And
look, there's a lot of reasons to be frustrated, pissed off, and negative vis-a-vis our body politic or our, you know, current administration. But the one good thing, the silver lining in all of this for me, was I think I have more. I appreciate the inherent flexibility of our democratic system, because it, you know, given the local, state, and federal model, I mean, we have a fucking broken federal system, and yet it flexed. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the local politicians, state politicians are doing their best to try to make it up, you know. So I don't know, for me, it, without getting into like a whole thing, like I think there was a lot, I know a lot of my liberal friends were like horrified as, you know, my candidate lost. But I mean, the point is that the sky didn't fall,
uh-huh.
you know, and it could still fall, you know, but it hasn't fallen yet. And I'm just grateful for this new energy and new optimism. Mm-hmm. Anyway, that's a little rant, kind of a random rant.
Yes.
That wasn't too bad of a rant.
All right, guys. So listen, before we sign off, I want to make sure our listeners know where to find you on social. JonMarc, where do people find you on the socials?
JMarket77. That's an Instagram. JMARKET77. JMarket. And I have a website, jmeart.com.
Right.
And like I said, it's up to date, up to 2018. So
I was on there last night, too. There is like that was a massive project organizing all that. You had so much content.
It started in 2010, and it's just, and the good thing is I can just add to it now.
Right. The structure's there, but
that's great.
Coco Sally, shout out.
Coco. So, and then prior to the show, you were talking about a video for Flutter that you're working on. Where and when can people enjoy that video?
Good question. I haven't selected or have a platform yet for that.
Okay.
We're still locking the image, and have to get back to me. You'll have to give me a...
So they'll probably be able to learn about it or see it on your Instagram or your website
sure
at some point.
If you look up Flutter at some point, it's going to pop up somewhere.
Okay. All right. Ando, where can people find you on social?
On social, it will be Ando, L-O-V-E, Ando Love.
Ando Love.
And the other www stuff is Search.
How do you spell Search?
Search as in the word, S-E-A-R-C-H.
Okay.
ResQ.com. So it's Search Rescue. And there's two sides to it. Website's totally outdated, but this year is coming up fresh. As you know, these things happen. It's always, you know, the minute you put something out, it's already old. But the plan is for this year, and focusing on revising a cleaner website that really showcases things that I've been involved with creatively. Mm-hmm. And the push is going to be towards getting a website that showcases all of my work, and a furniture collection, or a couple of collections that I have. And there's one that I'm currently excited to release and launch this year. So the website will have that, which is very clean aesthetics, modern, very functional, playful, sculptural pieces of art that are also furniture.
Sounds hot. Sounds like I have some new furniture in my future.
It's coming. It's super fresh.
I love it.
Very brand driven. All made in LA, hand finished, machine.
Right.
You know, digitally manufactured. So that's what's coming up. But in the meantime, just keeping focused.
Beautiful.
And allowing all good things to blossom.
Well, that's beautiful, man. That's beautiful. And well, before we go, I have a couple things I need to ask of you guys. A couple favors.
Sure.
Are you down for a little help?
Yeah.
Can you help me? I need all the help I can get.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the help I need involves supporting our mission to help, you know, democratize art world. Okay. Spread the love. So we have a conference coming up March 16th, Not Real Art Conference,
yes,
at the base in LA here.
Excited
in,
about that.
In LA. So I hope you guys will come. Will you come to the conference?
Yes.
Will you?
Indeed.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's a couple of days after my birthday, so it's the celebration of the month
of March
continues.
Yeah. Maybe that's a roof.
Yeah.
We might have to have a little shout out, birthday shout out at the conference.
I'm there.
Fantastic.
Yes,
so,
absolutely.
Well, I hope you guys can come. Hope you will be there. For our listeners, they can learn about the conference at notrealart.com. The other thing I want your help with is a petition I'm starting. We're on a mission to revolutionize talk radio and revolutionize arts education by bringing the arts to talk radio.
Cool.
And we're going to be starting a petition to demonstrate the want and need and demand for such a thing. So I'm asking for your support of the petition.
Absolutely.
And to share it with your friends and family.
Absolutely.
And get their
signatures
as well.
Count us in.
That'd be beautiful.
I'll mark it twice.
Definitely.
Thank you, guys. Yeah, yeah. Sign it twice.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I love it. Guys, I tell you what, man. I can't tell you how grateful I am for the generosity of time and energy that you guys came in to sit down with little old me and have a fun, inspiring conversation about our mutual love and passion for art and creativity. It has been a real joy. I hope you'll come back.
Thank you. This was
great.
And for our listeners, be sure to please comment and like the episode and subscribe to the podcast and tell all your friends to check out Not Real Art. We're signing off. Have a good year, gentlemen.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having us.
Bye.
And for those of you that are listening, Not Real Art has a really amazing space to be in and to talk about it. And it wouldn't be as exciting if we were in a room with bare walls and nothing.
It's got a good vibe. We got a good vibe.
Yeah, it's super fresh. And so thank you so much. And I'm looking forward to celebrating the event in March.
Thank you, Ando.
And
thank you, brother.
Till the next time with JonMarc, we'll be blowing some letters your way.
Cheers.
Cheers, everybody. Peace out.